You know, looking back, maybe the bye week couldn't have came at a worse time for the Vikings, something you won't hear very often. It's obvious the Vikings' bye halted a tremendous amount of momentum that helped them get to 5-0, only to come out of the week of rest to look sluggish and lost in many areas. No area looked worse, though, in their past two games than the offensive line. With the exception of maybe Joe Berger, the unit has been horrendous from top to bottom, with nearly every player struggling in one facet or another. In Philadelphia, the team tried to get cute and sprinkle in newcomer Jake Long, who had only one full padded practice. The result was bloodshed, giving up over 20 quarterback pressures, which was over half of Bradford's dropbacks. He also was hit 11 times, which resulted in the team's first of four turnovers on the year. Last week against the Bears was technically better on paper, but nowhere near what a functioning O-line should look like, surrendering 12 pressures, 9 quarterback hits, and 5 sacks. I cut up a handful of plays from Monday night to see just what went wrong, but arguably the most alarming and discouraging sign that I saw was just how relentless the Bears' pass rush was, while only sending 3 or 4 guys. That's right, the Bears were able to get consistently good pressure without sending a blitzer. Let's check out the tape, and I'll show you what I mean. Backyard football, 1 Mississippi, 2 Mississippi, 3 Mississippi. Yikes. Pretty much how Sam Bradford's last 2 weeks have gone, though. Check it out, though. You've got 4 pass rushers versus 6 blockers with Rudy and a chip as Asiata leaks out of the backfield. But yet you see Bradford tries to go through his progressions and reads, scanning the field from his left side over to the right side, but there's just no time as TJ Clemmings gets caught leaning at the point of attack, and Pernell McPhee uses his lower leverage to just push him aside with great hand technique to get after the passer in an instant. TJ Clemmings making McPhee look like the next coming of Reggie White. Okay, let's slide down the line and keep them coming. 61, Brandon Fusco on the spotlight next as he just gets shoved backwards right from the snap. Overpowered and overmatched. I wish we were breaking down a fun spin move or cool club and rip, but no, just raw power versus Fusco is all it takes here as it allows Bradford zero room to step up into a clean pocket and climb the ladder. Freeze it here. And cue the circus music. This just kills me. One picture to sum up the Vikings O-line play the last 2 weeks. You've got 3 of the 5 on the ground just chilling. Long falls to the ground on the edge while Fusco takes out his own player and Berger. It's just classic. Taking a closer look, though, Fusco tries to ride his man inside but loses leverage and slips on a Soldier Field turf that has never been known to have great footing, falling to the grass and allowing his man to attack the quarterback from inside the pocket. Well, the Bears are thinking if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Again, just 4 pass rushers to the Vikings' 5 blocking offensive linemen. The Bears get Fusco again here by just shoving him back, plain and simple. Fusco is thrown back instantly in the pocket 3 to 4 yards, which really is just inexcusable, allowing once again interior pressure on Bradford, forcing him to roll out of the pocket and having no opportunity to go through his reads and progressions. As he gets shoved back to the turf, Fusco once again manages to take out his own man in the process and TJ Clemmings, who trips and falls backwards with Fusco behind him at his feet. The Bears taste blood in the water, and they're after 63, Brandon Fusco, who once again is just downright bullied by Willie Young from the inside. Just 4 pass rushers versus the Vikings' 5 offensive linemen, and yet Bradford can't even get all the way set in his drop back and go through his reads before there's a 300-pound defensive lineman in his face ready to squash him like a bug. Luckily, Ronnie Hillman is able to get out of the backfield quick enough to give Bradford somewhere to throw the ball away quickly, but if you're coach, you have to find a way to get Fusco some help on the inside with Joe Berger helping double-team. Otherwise, a personnel switch is really the only other solution. Well, the run game looked slightly improved versus the Eagles last week, but with no Jerick McKinnon versus the Bears, defense honed in on Matt Asiata's running style and swallowed him up. But it's not like there were massive holes to run through, however. Here, Joe Berger does a good job of helping double-team with Alex Boone and then quickly getting to the second level to seal off a linebacker. But once again, Brandon Fusco is immediately pushed back into the hole and running lane and forces Asiata to try to get what he can before being tackled for a loss. Meanwhile, TJ Clemmings is blocking literally no one there for a second. It's likely he was supposed to help double-team with Rudolph, but when you see Rudy has his man sealed on the edge, he should be exploding into the second level. You know, the run game for the Vikings continues to be a mess, and clearly it starts up front. One way to isolate a good pass rush is with screen passes. Finally, Norv dials one up here. On this screen pass, it looks as though your three interior linemen are the ones that will let their men through and go out and block for the would-be pass catcher. And they do a good job of trying to time the rush with the pass. However, poor old TJ Clemmings, who's supposed to stay in and block to sell the play, he's caught leaning once again, this time by Willie Young, who then takes advantage, swiping his hands away and swimming by his off-balanced body. You can tell TJ isn't supposed to let his man through because he runs after him, trying to save his quarterback from dying. Because Clemmings isn't able to block his man, Young is able to get after Bradford before he can get the pass off in time, blowing up the play. Finishing up with a handful of goal line plays, here Asiata tries to punch this one in, but as the D-line crashes down, plugging up the middle and squeezing everything to the outside, rookie tight end David Morgan tries and double-team the D-end, which would have been better served at getting up to the second level to try and seal off number 50 linebacker Jarrell Freeman. After forced outside, Asiata would have then had a better opportunity matched up on the small frame cornerback on the very outside that you see. Tough play for a rookie to dissect all of that in just a split second. Here you've got a hat on a hat, but down in the goal line formation, I'm not too keen on having your wide receiver as one of your lead blockers. Here Patterson is asked to create a hole for Asiata, and to be honest, he does an okay job against number 29. Unfortunately, Asiata loses his vision in the pile and just puts his head down, trying to hammer his way in, ultimately smashing right into Patterson instead. Had he been able to keep his head up, he may have been able to squeeze through the crack Patterson opened for him. You know, in the future, if you're going to have your wide receiver block at the goal line inside the tackles, I'd be interested to see rookie wide receiver Laquon Treadwell get an opportunity here, as he was one of the best blocking wide receivers in the country at Ole Miss just last year. Another goal line attempt here. The handoff sweep is directed towards the right side of the line, and initially the Vikings have a hat on a hat and do a good job, as the hope is creating an opportunity with Asiata one-on-one versus a linebacker. However, the first two to lose their ground are the guards inside with Fusco and Boone, who are pushed back into the running lane and force Asiata to try and swing the play back to the left, which ends up for close to no gain. I'm not saying it's easy down at the goal line, because with multiple 340-pound defensive tackles, it's not. But at some point, you have to find a way to get a positive push forward to help your running back find a crease to sneak through. With the run game stuck in neutral, down at the goal line, the Vikings try a pass. And once again, you'll see the Vikings have more blockers than pass rushers with the 4-on-5 advantage. But with Fusco unable to help out in any facet and do anything, Berger is pushed back into the pocket immediately by Willie Young in synchronized fashion, with Jake Long being shoved back into Bradford's backside as well. Bradford has no time to go through his reads, and Bradford is taken down for another sack. When you can get constant pressure with just your front four, things become vastly different for the rest of your defense. The Vikings need to find a way how to block really anyone at this point, or their once promising start will continue to spiral down into an ugly second half of the season. For everybody at Cold Omaha and ColdOmaha.com, I'm Luke Inman, signing out.